Podcasters Roundtable, round 83, podcast distribution. We have a subtitle today, go to your audience. And actually, if you have a beverage, go ahead and consume that. I've got water and beer here. I need a sip of my beer because today, man, it's just not going well. It's not going well, but that is live production in a nutshell. The Roundtable, in theory, has a new channel. I split the YouTube channel. Won't go into that, but it does have that new YouTube smell, but you guys can't smell it.
Oh, yeah.
You can't smell it because we're not there. So we'll hopefully next time be on that channel. I'm going to upload it to that. But yeah, that smell is called starting over from zero subs. But anyways, so I want you to go subscribe to the channel because mainly I don't want you to miss the content. Use a little notification. After you subscribe, there's a little icon of a bell. Use that and say, yeah, I want to be notified because all you're going to get is when we are live. It's really the only thing that's going to be on this channel unless we do something that is special. But right now you can use podhelp.me/PRTube, and PRTube is all in caps. Once we get to that 100 subs, that's why it's important for you to go sub. Once we get to 100 subs and we're 30 days old, big 30 days old, we'll be able to get the custom URL. It'll be easy for me to say something like podcasters or youtube.com/podcastersroundtable. But right now, Dave, type that in the chat, podhelp.me/PRTube. All right, so please do that. And let's meet the roundtable. We want to get started. It should be a good one. Daniel J. Lewis, welcome back.
Thank you. I'm from theaudacitytopodcast.com. So sorry for the YouTube stuff. But, you know, when all of us start a new show, I think we all feel that kind of thing. We need to reach our audience.
This is a perfect, and I think you are doing your job here as a co-host, and you're bringing us into the conversation because we're going to be trying to figure out how do we find that audience, especially when we're new, which is kind of a good round to, in theory, to have a new channel, but we are trying to build subs on that new channel. So we need to reach those people. YouTube is going to be one of those ways for us because we are an audio-only podcast. That's the only part that lives in a podcast feed that then live streams on YouTube. So Dave Jackson, welcome back.
Yeah, Dave Jackson from the School of Podcasting. And it is kind of fun going back to the beginning. And it's we're getting ready to climb that hill again. It'll be fun to watch.
Yeah, and I think I just left some stats for you guys in the, and we have our own and podcast roundtable Slack. Go ahead, Dave.
podhelp.me/PRTube.
TUBE.
Got it.
It's yeah, like just the Wi-Fi password.
Yeah, it is. It is. So, yeah, I just showed that we're getting some nice retention. If you look at YouTube stats at all, you'll see that YouTube retention is hard to get. Maybe 3.5 minutes, you'll keep half your audience. But we do pretty well for the percentage of people who are watching an hour-long video. So if you aren't watching us, if you're listening on the audio only, you don't have to. Didn't do anything. Actually, I even did change. I did a 301 redirect even on that feed. So things are just, we are chaos here. But Glenn, welcome back to the roundtable.
Hey guys, Horse Radio Network here. Glad to be here tonight talking about how to build an audience.
Yeah, and you were here recently, but I'm not sure we had your video.
No, we didn't. Can you see me tonight?
We can see you.
I got my Christmas lights up. I'm ready.
Yeah, that's perfect. Daniel's got his Christmas theme LEDs and his sound panels back there, very fancy. So you definitely want to check out the video for that. But yeah, we're going to talk about distributing your podcast, getting to your audience. Maybe your audience isn't even listening to a podcast yet. Glenn deals with that a lot, and yet he's extremely successful with his show. And that's one of the reasons we had him back. A, we wanted to see him this time. B, he's just way too much content. Last time I felt like we didn't even get I had to have Glenn by himself because he just has that much great content. You have to hear what Glenn has to say. So we're going to dive into it. I think this is a good roundtable for that, even though we don't have a new roundtabler. But hey, always be experimenting.
Wait, so, Glenn's video is new.
I'm half new.
He is half new. That's right. We only had half a Glenn last time. That's right. We got 0.5 new roundtablers. I like it. All right. So let's see. The first thing we need to talk about when discussing, I guess, podcast distribution. We covered it a bit in previous rounds about iTunes. Then we had one called Beyond iTunes. And this was sort of all the places to distribute, I mean, traditionally, your podcast. And these are, you know, podcast directories. So round 35 and 40, if you're interested in those. But my first question is, once you are well represented in the top podcast directories, iTunes, Stitcher, What's another one you have to submit to? Google Play.
Tune in,
right? These ones. Once you're in those, where do you go next? So I guess let's just start really open-ended right there. And whoever wants to jump in with, once you're in the big ones, you submit, you're in iTunes, name and lights, where do you go next? Is that it? You just stop there?
Daniel, feel free to plug your website, because that's what I was going to mention anyway.
Well, podcastplaces.com lists all the places you and your podcast should be. It's a little bit outdated now, so I welcome anyone to provide corrections, provide input on that. But there are dozens, maybe even hundreds, of other podcast apps and directories. But if you hit those top ones we just mentioned, that puts you in most of the places out there. Like Overcast, for example, just uses the iTunes search.
Most of the places where people listen to podcasts, right? But Glenn, you have a show where someone who wants to hear it is probably not searching iTunes.
That's right. All my shows, I do get people searching iTunes, but it's less and less, actually.
You do, but I'm saying like there's a large part of your audience who, or let's put it this way, potential audience.
Right.
There's people who would like to listen to your stuff, but don't know you exist, and they're not going to be in iTunes looking for you, right? They're not listening to other podcasts where then they can find the Horse Radio Network.
Can I get on my soapbox now? This is my soapbox here. This business is hard. It's hard. When you start out, it is not easy. You're going to feel depressed and dejected because people are not miraculously finding you in the thousands of podcasts that are on iTunes or wherever else they're consuming podcasts. You need help. And the way we did it 8 years ago and have continued to do it is we found help. We found partners. And what I call them media partners. We now have 70 media partners that we work with in our niche. That's 70. And I wrote down, I just did a list today of some of the quick ones that I thought would be the most interesting. And I sent this to a couple of you, and it's a whole page of just the ones that I could think of off the top of my head.
So I have a question. Where, after you create the podcast, the RSS feed, you got out there in iTunes, of this list, which I don't know if I'm looking at the right list. You did send me some notes, which are awesome. Glenn doing overtime on the Roundtable. Where was the first place you went out to?
I started with bloggers. We started our first episode with a blogger. We had a blogger on because I wanted the blogger to do a post about it because we didn't have any listeners at that point. The blogger did. So that kind of worked. We got some listeners right away from the blogger. So I started with bloggers. Then we reached out to magazines and then associations and then businesses. That was the order of events that we did it.
What was the most successful in the beginning to find that audience?
The magazines.
And what were you telling people? What were you putting in a magazine to get people back to iTunes?
Not the thing. We're not putting anything in a magazine. We were building relationships with magazines. So I would go to a magazine and say, look, we have a podcast. You have a magazine. We're not really competing. So why don't we work together? You come on and do content on one of my shows. In exchange, you promote our shows I asked them to put them on their homepage, and a lot of them did. So they would put the links in a player on their homepage. And then some of them actually put free ads in the magazine for the show, although I don't know that we got much out of that. But and they were also posted on social media, which was what I was really looking for. So we exchanged content. They got something they didn't have, a podcast on their website. They also got to advertise their magazine in our show by helping us with content. So the magazines, because they already had tens of thousands of loyal followers, now they were saying, go try this out, that we're part of this, we're a partner with them. And that's really what worked. And oh, by the way, everything I'm going to talk about today didn't cost a dime. No money.
It did. What did it cost?
Time.
Time.
Time and your effort. And promotion of someone effort. Else, right? The yeah. Advertising. It's all kind of like, almost like an... It's not an ad for someone else, but
it's a media partner. Yeah. You know, we're partners. We truly are partners.
Do you know how long it took to get like your first one?
We had our first one within 6 months, and by the way, they still carry all of our shows on their website, and it is the largest magazine, oldest magazine, it's 100 years old in our industry. And they still have a section on their website for all of our shows and list them and have our players. And that's 8 years later.
I just think it's the thing about that is I have people now that they'll put out four episodes and they're like, should I pivot? And I'm like, well, you just jumped in the water. What are you talking about?
Started.
It's like, hard. Glenn just told you how hard this is.
It is hard. And, I have some examples, too, I'll give you as we go on the conversation, because I think having the examples will help give people ideas of what they can do when they approach the magazines and the blogs and the associations and those people, because I think that's important to hear the examples of what different things you can do to make that happen. I don't know if I'm the only one out here doing this, but right now we have found in our industry, I've been contacted. We have two magazines starting their own shows on our network in January. Magazines are going to be the biggest growing area getting into podcasting in the next year. And the magazines have something that you all don't have. They have tens or hundreds of thousands of followers already. So they have believers. They have also have believers that have name recognition for the writers and the people who write for the magazine. So now those writers come on to be a host on the show. They already have people who know who they are and want to hear from them. So they have this huge advantage going in.
Yeah, definitely. They have distribution already and they have an audience, right? So
I'll tell you what they don't have, though. They don't have people. They don't have manpower to do their own shows. They don't have time. They're all short-staffed.
And that's what I'm going to ask. Are they cross-promoting your show or are you talking about them adding a podcast?
They're adding their own podcast and we're doing all the production.
What's the pitch on that?
Like, and putting it on we're taking the production out of their hands. Plus in our case, we're putting it on the network, which already has a lot of listeners.
What does a magazine think about putting content that they want people to read or subscribe to in a magazine out for free in a podcast?
It's just a marketing source for them. They're realizing they have to do this because I'm doing it, you're doing it, other people are doing it already. They might as well be doing it themselves.
Is it generating subscribers paid subscribers to their magazine?
Yes. And oh, by the way, we have three magazines that pay us every month advertising because they drum up subscribers. In exchange for that, I have them help us with content. So they come on, they'll talk about one of the articles. They'll bring one of the people that were highlighted in one of the articles on, and we'll do a whole conversation with them to kind of go beyond what the article talked about. So for us, it's good content, and they're paying to be advertisers with us. So yeah, they're always looking for ways to advertise and to market and promote, and their ways that they've been doing for years aren't working as well either. So they're having to do new things.
So where's the bulk of your podcast audience coming from? Is it coming from that you know of? Is it coming from iTunes or podcatchers or website or?
It's everything. I mean, we have 70 websites that have our links. Mm-hmm. We have our own app, which has tens of thousands of downloads now. So that helps us out a lot.
So so that's to interrupt there because we're talking about people who are not maybe necessarily listening to podcasts. Maybe this is their first podcast. When you reach out or they get in touch with you, does the app really help with that? Or is the app just a value add?
I think a lot of people find us through the app because they'll search for us and the app will come up in the app store. And then they'll give it a try. But word of mouth is our biggest now.
Free or do you have to pay more? Free. Would charging for your app be a barrier to distributing?
Yes. No doubt.
I think that's pretty universal for content creators, that the app is really a marketing aspect, not a money-making aspect, unless you have such a loyal following that you can provide extra bonuses inside the app. But even then, I think that would be smarter to do as an unlock, like an in-app purchase.
I've had a couple of advertisers now asking me, I'm looking into this, about putting advertising on the app. And putting small banner ads on the app. That I've gotten requests for, and I've been resisting it because I kind of wanted to keep the app clean.
Who makes your app? I mean, how would you even have the ability to do that?
One of my listeners did it. And
is this a business they want to start for value for podcasters?
He is a really, really smart guy and knew how to do all this stuff anyway. So he has an app of his own that's in the horse world, and I traded him advertising for building our app.
You know, I don't think we got to that part. Like, we're talking about, I'm kind of referring to this audience that doesn't listen to podcasts. Glenn, what is your show and why are you reaching an audience that maybe necessarily is not listening to podcasts already?
Well,
what's your show about?
We did 10 shows. We have 10 shows now. It'll be 12 in January. And it's all horses, all different niches in the horse world. Everything's horse and all niches in the horse world. And the horse world's, you know, the horse world's 9 million people. You know, so I take a look at our audience and go, wow, we got a lot of growth, right? We have a lot of potential for growth. And that's in the United States, by the way. So it's 9 million people in the United States, you know, and I think, you know, it was a hard battle for us for 7 years. We had to educate people how to listen. That was the first thing. If you go to my website at horseradionetwork.com, you're going to see one of the first things you see is big buttons on how to listen. And you click on that button and it goes through exactly step by step how to listen. So we do a lot of education. Now, in the last year or two, thanks to everything that's happened in podcasting last night or two nights ago, thanks to Jimmy Fallon making fun of it, that all helps. you know, so, but it's become much easier and people are figuring it out. And then starting the search for horse podcasts, and when they do, we're it. So, SEO too, by the way, has helped us. If you search for a horse podcast now in Google, you're going to find us.
So
if
wait, SEO has helped you, or your podcast has helped your SEO?
Both. I think it's both, because we've been really good about show notes from day one and putting and really good about the guests. So if we've had 6,200 guests now. That's 6,300 now. So when you search for one of those people, you're going to see a professional rider. You search for them, their website, and then it's our website.
I know. Okay. So here you go. You guys write this down. I bet you're listing all 6,300 people in your author tag. Is that right in iTunes? No. That's iTunes SEO. I learned it from happen. Daniel. No. That ain't happening. Check out Daniel's recent episode on, you know, podcast SEO. It's good. You'll learn to, things you probably shouldn't be doing.
Yeah.
Maybe things you should be doing. But I mean, SEO is important. I mean, show notes, you're saying, because podcast on the web, a podcast is not necessarily going to do anything for you. You still have to write the text, right?
Yeah, but people still Google for stuff. So when they Google, oh, I heard about podcasting. I wonder if there's a horse one. They don't go to iTunes to do that. They Google it.
Let me write that down.
Am I wrong about that?
People Google for stuff.
Yeah, right. They still Google for stuff.
Let me check out Google. Let me check that.
But you know, that's why we have spent, and you know, we don't do transcriptions, and I know a lot of people do, and I think it's probably great, but we do too many shows. We put out 15 to 20 shows a week. It would cost me $10,000 a week to do transcriptions.
So you're showing it's not necessary. And in fact, good show notes are probably better than transcripts because they're organized. They're not just rambling on. Text,
and Google
right?
still looks for updates. You know, I still come back to the thing I preach to everybody that starts a show, and it's written in our contracts for anybody who starts a show with us, is you cannot miss episodes. You're consistent, consistent, consistent. If you're weekly, you're weekly, and you never miss. And in 5,000 episodes, we've never missed an episode. And that's important for Google, too, because they want that website updated all the time. And I don't think that's changed, has it, Daniel? They're still looking for that.
Right. Yeah, they'll look for the quality of the content. They look at how frequently is the website updated with new, fresh content that is equally high quality. It's you're building a reputation, and Google is measuring that basically in all of their secret algorithms that they tweak on a regular basis.
And so I think that, you know, this whole conversation is part of distribution, right? Your website is a big distribution point. There are people who start a podcast and either not have a website or will say you don't need a website. But I think
what I'm saying is all of it's important.
Yes.
We're getting new listeners from everywhere. All of it's important. If you want to build a show that truly is, you know, and if you want to eventually, and I think everybody does, maybe in the back of their mind want to be full time at it, you know, like my wife and I are, you've got to be thinking on all cylinders from day one. And yeah, that takes time. It doesn't cost money, by the way. It's not money. It's time.
Time is money, Glenn. Time is money.
Well, you're right. You're right. Time is money. And by the way, the bigger you get, the more that becomes true.
Yeah.
Right, Dave?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's...
Dave says he doesn't understand that concept because he just starts another show. Dave, you have a new show about a bot. So,
yeah. That's going to be my new podcast. It's going to be how to podcast at 2 a.m. and still sound like you're awake, because that's about what I'm doing. So it's crazy.
Nice. I'm learning that in my advanced age here, which, you know, whatever. Yeah. But I can't just shoot a video anytime I want. Like, I took a nap the other day and I turned on the camera. I was like, oh boy, you can't. I mean, these bags are just, it's not working out, man. So I post 40. If you thought I was 38, all of you I know.
Well, speaking of age, I think some of the methods that we're talking about are a bit age constrained.
Oh,
I'm not outdated, but I think, like, my generation and younger, the senior millennials, and well, I really don't like
senior millennials.
I don't senior like lumping myself. I am not a millennial in behavior, but technically I am like at the top of the
give us an age group.
Yeah, so 30s and below or
okay,
so.
There we go. Okay.
These people are not reading magazines as much anymore. They have a constant connection to the internet. They're extremely
I'll argue
familiar.
With you a little bit.
Okay.
What niche ooh. You're in.
Duke
well,
out.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Depends okay. on the niche.
Yeah, because mine are. They love seeing pictures of horses. So they still get the magazines. And they'll read the magazines, you know, at times when they can't necessarily reach new media or their phones. It's amazing in certain niches, and I bet you look in skiing and some of the other niche areas, you're going to find that that's magazine subscriptions in the horse world are increasing, not decreasing.
Interesting.
Patrick Keller asked this question kind of relating to this. How do you reach the young people though? Like outside of, I can't think of any other way to put it, but outside of the like the country people, the people who maybe don't have technology so integrated into their lives, but the people who are suburban or urban, right. but not rural, how do you reach them, that next generation, the people who aren't reading paper or touching paper?
And I think that's a special challenge because I think below a certain age, you don't listen to podcasts. Like who podcasts and stuff for your parents? Like I didn't used to love the History Channel. Like My stepdad used to watch home. What's one of the home building shows? The old
you're
this old house.
It now, aren't you? The
hated it. There it is. I hate it. Now I love it. So I think there becomes an age where this type of content.
Top there.
Oh yeah, there's plenty of gray. It's red and gray and white. There's all kinds of stuff. There's less of it, but you know, this type of content, spoken word. You know, you don't have teenagers flipping on NPR for the most part. I'm overgeneralizing. So it's harder to reach. There are harder demographics. I think you have to make, now that it's so custom, podcast is, we're getting niche, as I heard someone say, we're getting niche with it here. You can speak to what they're interested in. So if you're trying to reach, now, you know, this show here, there's plenty of young people podcasting. So I just need to appeal to whatever their needs are in podcasting, right? So I think, you know, Glenn, I mean, with a horse show or, you know, Dave with a show, you know, about the Alexa. I mean, you just would have to be where they're at having those conversations. Maybe they're hacking their Alexa or something, right? I don't know. Do you guys think that's it? Well, is there more to it? Well,
and I would come back to the same thing. Where are they at? Where are they reading their content? They're going someplace. And that's the place you need to go.
Snapchat. Whether it's
well, and I don't know how you break that one without, you know, you have to be in that world to break well, that one.
That's the thing, is that the younger generation, you have to be in their world. Their attention spans are getting shorter. I think that's why Snapchat works so well, as, hey, I don't have attention for much more than an extremely short thing, and I don't really care about it after 24 hours, so might as well make it disappear. Snapchat so totally describes that generation, millennials and whatever the next generation after that is called. That I think that, yeah, being there where they are and making snippets, making things that can connect with them is a way to build your audience with them, because I just can't see that generation wanting to sit down and listen to a half hour long thing, but they'll sit down and they'll watch an entertaining 5 or 10 minute thing, or especially watch a short 30 second thing.
And that's really the key, I think. In no matter what your audience is, you have to figure out, hey, who are they? And then you have to go where they're at, whether that's magazines or blogs or radio or some sort of social media, or, you know, whatever it is, you have to figure out who are they? And then you have to figure out where they're at. To otherwise, you know, how are they going to know you're alive, basically?
Let's take an example from the chat. Chris says, what's a good way to promote a TV fan show podcast, right? So I guess you want to get in front of the TV show viewers. You're not the official podcast, so you're not going to be listed probably on the show. An app could be a good way, because they're probably searching for content related to the show in iTunes. What do you guys think? Daniel, you have a TV show fan podcast. Anything different that you can do there to reach the people were watching the TV.
Yeah. What you don't want to do, first, I'll tell you this, is don't go to the TV fan forums and post a link to your podcast. Now, you can go there and...
Because you did this and it was...
It's spam. It really is spam. What you could do is you could pick one, maybe, when you're starting out. Go there and participate in conversations. And then when you can say, hey, we talked about this in our podcast. And maybe eventually you'll build relationships and other people will start sharing your stuff in those places. I think a big thing is follow the hashtags. TV shows have official hashtags. And whether that be that you get on Twitter and like you use tchat.io or tweetchat.com and you use the hashtag as a chat room and you respond to people, especially during the show in different time zones. And maybe even you can see people tweeting certain things that you address in your podcast. So you can reach out to them and you can point them back to your podcast. That's how I grew the Audacity to Podcast in the very beginning. When at that time, I thought my specialty was Audacity. I was searching Twitter for any time anyone would say Audacity and any form of the word podcast together, I would see that tweet.
And I used to have an account called Podcast Genie at Pod. I don't know if I still own it because I was stalking Twitter in the same way. So I would just pop up. People would like put a question about their podcast in Twitter. And I would just be like, pop up like a genie. I'm like, hey, you asked a question. Let me answer it. They're just like, what is weirdness? So yes, I'm down.
Three wishes.
You've got three podcast questions.
And I have an example for you on that one. I'm a big fan of The Blacklist. So I actually started searching and I found The Blacklist fan site. And on The Blacklist fan site, The Blacklist Exposed podcast was one of the things they listed.
And there is a possibility to maybe work with them.
That's what I'm talking about.
A media
partner.
Not the beginning necessarily.
We're back to that again.
Well, and they have. Troy has, over the years, built up. He's actually met with a producer, and they just hired him. They flew him to Los Angeles, and he did some sort of video thing that they didn't air it in the U.S., but they did. Like, he was part of
the junket thing.
Yeah, a TV show that went out in the other countries. Mm-hmm. So, very much so. He's been and he just got tons of behind the scenes stuff that you just can't get, which just adds legitimacy to his podcast. And
awesome. That's not a short show either.
Right. Well, and this stuff is, this goes back to Glenn's opening premise. This stuff is hard, right? It's not like he did that after episode two. It's not like they took notice that, hey, oh, someone started a podcast about our show. Thank you so much. Why don't you come to LA? No, how many episodes did he do? How much did he interact
with? I don't think it was as many as you think, but he was consistent in what he did do.
All right. Well, now the dreamers can come back. Yeah, see, and one episode and you're in. I'm just kidding.
The other thing he did that was different was like he dove in like every door that he could get to that show. Yeah. Like he started talking about the writers. I'm like, the who? Yeah, and then the writers, like, wow, writers are like anybody else. They're like, hey, they're talking about me on the podcast. And then it was the producer. It's like, wait a minute, how come you interviewed one of the writers and you haven't asked the guy that started the show yet? So it was the creator of the show was listening to the show that he's like, hey, where's my invite? And they're like, well, they didn't want to invite him because he was the big cheese. So,
you know, one of the cool things you can do with that, combining this with TV show fan podcast, or maybe you can apply this to a different niche, is try to interview some of the people, because you can leverage interviews, but you can work your way up. You probably have your A-list of people that you think, like if you have a TV show fan podcast, oh, I'd love to get so-and-so. Like for my podcast, I'd love to talk to Josh Dallas, Jennifer Morrison, Jennifer Goodwin, Kitsis and Horowitz. I'd love to have any of them on the podcast. I can't just reach out to them cold and say, hey, you want to be on the podcast? Well, I could, but they wouldn't really care. But I could start out with, okay, there's a special person who appeared in this one episode. They were there for one scene. Maybe I can interview them and start out small. And then they can then share and say, hey, I had a fun interview. They respected my time. They asked good questions. It was a great conversation. I'm sharing this out with all of my huge fans. And I'm not saying you rely on your guest, because it goes back to my favorite ever quotation from Dave Jackson. Cue the quote, Dave.
it's actually, it's not the size of the guest that brings value. It's the size of the value that makes a great guest.
Thank you, Dave, because I'll tell you what, we've had some, 6,200 guests. We've had some big names on that have been terrible guests. They're, you know, just because they're a big name doesn't mean they're a great interview. And, you know, you see actors go on the Tonight Show and on the evening shows and you go, well, that was a horrible interview. They're a great act, but they're not necessarily a good interview.
Which is sad because unlike a podcast, those have been rehearsed, basically. Exactly.
Yeah. And they're still terrible.
Still bad.
Yeah, you know, and so we've had writers on, we've had the directors on, we've had all of those.
What do you do with a cruddy interview? Still allow it? You still put it out there? It's bad in your opinion, right? The thing is, it might not be bad in everyone's opinion.
Well, that's right. And, you know, I've had interviews that I thought were terrible, and I get the most mail on them saying they loved it. And I'm going, what the heck did they like about it?
Yeah, we've had rounds here that I was like, yeah, that one wasn't so good. And then it's got some of the best stats, and people say, great round. It's like, hey, I have to take myself out of it.
Yeah, you do. You do. And I have that happen every week.
Yeah. And one of those tips, we're talking about interviews and getting people on. A long time ago, I produced a music show for some of my friends. And during that, I mean, it was like probably 2008. So it was early days. And we had a musician on. And then later on, I went to his Facebook page and he had like 175,000 people on this page. I was like, whoa, lightning struck and light bulb went off and every other cliche. And I was like, let me get in touch. This person needs to post the show on their page, not me posting it, if they need to do it. And I had to get, you know, someone who at that point he's got a handler or something. But getting them to post on, check, see if they have Facebook, check their social. If they can mention it, you know, give them the resources to share, make it very easy for them. And, you know, then it just puts you in front. I mean, you just interviewed that musician. Of course, that person's fans, that's content they want.
So. Wait, we had one on Monday. We did our 12-hour live Radiothon, which is now our second annual. And we started with Christian Bush of Sugarland. And he spent a half an hour with us. And he made the big announcement on our show that they're going to be getting back together. They've been not together for 3 years and they're going to be getting back together. Well, he has 5 million followers on Facebook. We elected not to have him post it before the live show because if a percentage of them had come, we would have been off the air for the 12 hours. You know, we would have been done. So we've elected to have him post it. He's going to post it now this weekend, you know, to the recorded version, because we just had to make that conscious decision. Do we want to be off the air for 12 hours? You know, it would have knocked us out.
And then there's another method there. You mentioned special events, right? I mean, we have International Podcast Day, which we all participate in. And that is some exposure that gets you in front of a new audience. You had your own marathon, right?
We started this last year and it's 12 hours live. I don't know why I picked 12 hours because I was a glutton for punishment. And we have 20 hosts this year. We have 20 hosts involved all day long. We rotate the hours. We have different themes each hour. And then we have two main MCs that are here in the studio with me. And then all the other hosts are remote. And then we have 24 scheduled guests. We started with Christian Bush. We had Ice Road Trucker Lisa Kelly on because she's a horse girl. And by the way, she has a 500,000 followers on Facebook. And then we have 20 of the big names in the horse world on. And we do it all day long. We get prize sponsors. We had 20 sponsors for this event. We gave away $4,200 worth of prizes on Monday. Day long, we gave away prizes. Listeners submitted voicemails where they sang songs about the Horse Radio Network and their favorite host or their horses or poems. We had 100 of those we played all day long.
And so it was a lot of fun for your present audience. But what about getting in front of new people?
Well, we hit almost 2 million people on Facebook with all the promotions leading up to it, because one of the requirements we have is if you're going to be a guest, a sponsor, or any way involved in it, you have to promote it for weeks ahead. So we had these people who have a 500,000 followers on Facebook posting it, our guests and things like that, and our sponsors.
What was the value? What was them? I mean, they're giving you something at that point. What's the value add for them to participate?
They get to be on our radiothon.
Yeah.
That's the value. Because in 2 years, it's become a thing.
And what's the point of the radiothon? What's its real?
For fun. It's to lead people into the holidays and have a good time. And so it's 12 hours of holiday fun. And the key is that the listeners get to participate. We had 160 callers, 100 of them sent in voicemails ahead of time. All of those people qualify for the prizes all day, so they get to win stuff. Our grand prize was $1,500 worth of stuff. So, you know, they want to be involved. Your listeners want to be involved so bad. And so many podcasts do not do anything with their listeners, and I don't understand that.
That's a good one. I mean, even on the Podcaster Studio, I used to be really good about bringing in the listener voicemail and stuff like that. And then that sort of changed. But yeah, I mean,
do you know why?
It is social media. It's a social media.
If your listener is on your show, they're telling everybody in their social media. They're telling everybody.
I remember when I was first on a podcast. Yeah. It was amazing.
Yeah,
that was maybe it might have been Dave's show. I called in and I was like, hey, I'm on the show. Check it out.
Christian
five
Bush.
And five is my best five.
And your big name guests might not tell anybody because they've been on 100 shows.
And it happens a lot. When we're talking about these big name guests, and a lot of times they won't promote, and it can be tough. And you really have to be in it to be giving the value to your audience. You got to be bringing them on because they're going to offer some. Because if you're expecting to happen, I mean, a lot of times you can't get to these people or their manager isn't going to post it. It might not happen, but there are things you can do around having that name. You've got a name there, right? So you better provide the value content. But now in iTunes, if someone's searching for you, you get the name. So there are things you get. So don't be depressed if someone doesn't then post it on their Facebook page.
And if your best friend at the barn, in my case, is on a podcast, and you're going to listen. Because you're going to want to hear what they do on the podcast, right? So that's the word of mouth I'm talking about. I'll give you a perfect example. This year on our show, on the Stable Scoop show, the first show, that was our premiere show, our flagship
Stable
show.
Stable Scoop sounds a little bit like a show I might not want to smell.
It's a Stable Scoop radio show, our first one, been 9 years now. We this year did Year of the Listener, which means all of our guests were listeners. So we've had by the end of this month, we'll have had 100 listeners on. And the numbers are up 25% this year on that show. Guess what? Where? It's their friends. They're promoting it out to their friends, and that's the reason the numbers are up on that show. And they've stayed up. So right. Some of them are hanging around.
That's the key. It's not that your buddy listened just to hear you. Right. It's that they actually found the content, and they're like, you know what? We're friends for a reason, probably because we have something in common, and now they're listening to the show.
They learned what the podcast was in many cases.
This is part of the... Well, there is a problem here in this interviewing other podcasters space, because what I find, like, I've been on, I don't know how many podcasts as a guest.
Wait, other podcasters or just interviewing?
Other podcasters. Okay. Or even kind of people in the same.
Right? Yeah.
Well, it's a two-sided thing is what I'm saying, is if you're interviewing someone else, they may be able to bring content that's relevant to your audience. That's fantastic. You know, it brings extra value to your audience. And that's what you should always be focused on, is bringing value to your audience. But does it bring value to their audience?
Hmm.
It's like if someone brings me onto their podcast to talk about Macs, Apple products. Okay, yeah, I'll promote it to my audience, and I enjoy certain Apple products as well, and I might enjoy being on someone else's Apple fan podcast. But will my audience really care that much about it? Maybe not, because it's not the kind of content my audience has come to expect. Now, we often, the three of us, Dave, Ray, and I, often hear from other people say, yeah, I discovered your podcast because of the Roundtable, or I discovered the Roundtable from your podcast, then that led me to someone else's podcast. So because we're all in the same industry, it's very likely that our audiences would be interested in crossing. What I see with Glenn is he has guests that are in the same industry. They don't have podcasts, and he's succeeding really well with his guests because they're in the same industry. So what he shares in his podcast, his guest's audience wants to share too. I mean, like if we had, what's a famous person in the, Chris Brogan. If we had Chris Brogan on this podcast, sure, that'd be really cool. People would think, oh, wow, Chris Brogan, he's famous social media guy on their podcast. But would his audience care about his being on here?
Pat Flynn was on here.
Is it bad that
right?
I don't know who he is, by the way?
Yeah, no, it's not bad at all.
Like, okay, good. Because I'm feeling left out here.
No, one knows outside of this, our bubble here. But hey, we had Pat Flynn on, right? If you look at the archives, it's like one of the few titles that actually has a name in it. It says Pat Flynn. So, you know, I'm using that a little bit. It's the same with Grammar Girl's been on here. But here's the key. Like, Pat Flynn's audience knows Pat Flynn's story. Dave, Daniel, myself, we go on shows, and you want to hear how I got into podcasting? My audience knows that. They've heard it so many times.
Yeah, you're right.
When Pat Flynn was on this show, we talked about podcasting success. And we tried to center the conversation around how Pat made a podcast successful, which he did something after he did blogging. I did some weird thing with my audio there. So in that case, hopefully it is a value to Pat's audience who are entrepreneur types and maybe thinking of starting a podcast. So yeah, I think it's a great point because my audience doesn't want to hear my story. They know it. So, you know, maybe, and Daniel, I don't know how you sort of, do you tweak that with the person who wants to have you in your show and say, hey, let's have a conversation about something else? Do you help control that or do you just don't promote it? What's the outcome of that?
I mean, Daniel, that was directed at Daniel, right? Or
Yeah. I'm just saying, Daniel's saying there's this issue where the content might not be valuable to our own audience. Do you have those conversations with other people who want to have you on a show? Do you try to guide the content in any way to make it more valuable for your own audience so that you can then share it?
Well, yeah. And most of the time that I'm invited to be on someone else's podcast, it's because they want to talk about podcasting on their podcast. And I appreciate those opportunities. What I kind of feel is, in some way, the bigger responsibility or the bigger challenge for me in those cases is here I'm talking about the same subject to audiences that aren't passionate about that subject. Like, I'm not talking about being on Dave's or Ray's show, but on being on, I can't think of a show right now, but being on someone else's show that's about something completely different, like a baby show, maybe, since Noodle Baby is going to be born very soon. Maybe they want to interview me, asking me what it's like to be a new dad. I'm mixing this all up.
It's going to be very hard to hold a Noodle Baby. Don't drop that kid. Okay. Like, I just don't see how. Yeah, it's very messy. And babies are messy.
Let me take two. This is going to be our edit point. We'll edit this in post so you won't have heard any of this. Yeah.
Notice the humor, like all the smiles coming out of Ray's face.
Three, two, one.
Okay. Take two. Like I was saying, my intelligent thought was, when I'm on someone else's podcast and I'm talking about podcasting, my challenge, I feel, is to make my niche relevant to their audience, because they may have the marketing podcast, the parenting podcast, the whatever podcast. They don't normally talk about podcasting. They invite me on to talk about podcasting, and I feel like it's a great opportunity. But I know probably most of your audience doesn't care about my niche. They care about your regular niche. So how am I going to make podcasting relevant to your niche?
Plus, you're not going to promote that yourself because people already know that. Your listeners already know that story.
I mean, yeah, that's the...
Well, yeah. I mean, for me, I just interviewed Michael O'Neill, who's the Solopreneur Hour guy's making six figures with his podcast. And I wanted to know, like, okay, what did you do? How did you start? And he also is doing some things I really like, but there was nothing in that interview that if I go out and look and see that Michael did zero promotion, I would not be surprised because his audience knew pretty much everything we talked about, I would assume in that, right. But I don't think my audience did. So it was content for me, but I didn't expect him to promote it.
Go ahead. Sorry.
I've actually decided to no longer participate in overly templatized interviews for partially this reason, that it's not really bringing any new content to me, to my audience, or to necessarily the audience of the podcast I'm supporting. But what I would love to do is, and this happened recently, Stefan Spencer, I think, is a member of Podcaster Society, and he wrote the book about SEO. Like, this book is bigger than the Bible. It's bigger than the dictionary. And he gave me one at Podcast Movement. It's this huge book on SEO. And I have an SEO for podcasters product. So he had me on his podcast and we talked about a specific topic that was relevant to his audience, relevant to my audience too. So I can point people to that episode to say, hey, we had this great conversation about this specific thing. He did research. He had a good conversation. So that enables me to better reach my audience with the content he pulled from me in his interview.
Can I circle back to where at the beginning?
Does it involve distribution of podcasts?
Yes. And yes, I wanted to give a couple more ideas. You know, I talked about magazines. I think that's going to be one of the biggest groups coming into our space in the next year doing podcasts. There's another group I'm seeing knocking at my door now, and that's associations. Every niche has associations. In our case, we have breed associations, discipline associations. We have a ton of different associations in the horse world. And a lot of times they're the they're the head association for a breed of horses.
9 years full-time podcaster. We have a network at our association, member organization, right?
Yep. So the associations are now looking at doing podcasts. And in our case, I have several that actually have been our sponsors for years that we've had involved in our shows that are now starting to look at doing their own. So associations, don't overlook associations. This is a matter of just contacting them and saying, look, I have a podcast that's in your space. I do something you don't do. Let's work together. Mm-hmm. It's not any more complicated than asking. What are they going to do? Say no?
But in that case, is that really about them getting them to start a podcast, which is a business for you? Or is it about getting your content, point?
Why doesn't your podcast become their podcast? You're working together. Again, it's a media partnership. You give them a spot, and that's what we do with the ones that we work with now. They may have a 5-minute segment once a month where they come on and do an update of what's going on in the association. Well, it's relevant to my audience because a lot of those people are in that same space that the association is in. What the association gets out of all of that is new memberships. And we've brought a lot of new memberships to the associations because they may not realize what the association does or that they, you know, there's different levels of membership, all of that. Mm-hmm. So working with them as a media partner, again, brings new listeners to your show. Now, part of the deal we make with them is we lay out exactly what they have to do for us. Social media posts, whether there's a link on the website, a banner. So we lay out exactly what they have to do for us. That's part of the deal in the beginning. And then you have to follow up, make sure they're doing it. That's the other thing. But there's new listeners. The other place we get new listeners and don't overlook is businesses. Give you a perfect example. We have the largest veterinary office in the United States has 55 veterinarians in the horse world. All they do is horses. They come on once a month and they do updates. They do health segments for us once a month. They promote that out to their social media religiously when they do that. And I know we've picked up new listeners, younger listeners, because everybody that has a horse, young or old, has a veterinarian, right? And cares about that. So we've actually picked up younger listeners because of our business contacts. We also work with the biggest publishing company in the horse world. They send us every horse book that comes out. We send them out to our listeners to review. We get the listener on the show to do the review. The listeners do all, I can't read. We get 5 to 10 books a month. I can't read them. So we started sending them out to listeners. They review them. They get to keep the book. The listeners now have started a book sharing program on Facebook where they're all sharing the books with each other when they're done reading them. So that happened, just the listeners doing it. But that publisher then promotes every single time we do a review on our shows. They're putting it out to their list. And oh, by the way, we have the authors on sometimes if the book's good, and the authors, PR people, are putting out press releases.
I was going to say, when the book sucks, because your audience, this comes down to trust issue, right? They're going to think, well, yeah, he does a review, it's favorable.
Something sucks about every product and book we review, by the way.
Right.
And we do that. We usually cover that 1-2 things that do suck about every product we review. There's always something you don't like. And, you know, we have had books that they've come on and said, look, this isn't my favorite thing. You know, it's just a review, right? It's a review by one listener who read a book. You know, and the publisher understands that going in. You know, they get negative reviews all the time.
Right.
They understand. They get negative reviews all the time. They're not always getting positive reviews. So we also, one other area I'll throw out at you, I know I'm throwing a lot of things, authors. On that same note, we have authors that have written really cool books that come on with us once a month and do segments with us that is relevant to the audience. I'll give you a perfect example. We have a lady that wrote a book about horses in history. She comes on and does a different horse every month out of her book. She covered 100 horses in her book. She comes on and talks about, she is so passionate and she shares it out with her audience. She has like 40,000 followers. She shares it out with her audience. They listen. We have new listeners from her. So we have other authors we work with too that way. All media partners. It's all free. All you have to do is ask.
Yeah.
But you have to really think outside the box,
right.
Go outside your comfort zone and ask. It's sales. All they can say is no, and you move on.
Yeah, and I think that's really kind of one of the things to draw from that. The moral is that, you know, think of try to think of all these different, you're connected to so many topics and types of media and people. And, you know, people wonder, how can you do a show about one little thing? You're in your niche and keep it going for 50, 100, 550 episodes. Well, you really have to drill down and think. Yeah, exactly. You really have to think, who else, where else can I bring the value, right? Is someone wrote a book in this space? Is there a magazine in this space? You know, there's just so many ways to approach it. And I think, you know, that's really good. And, you know, it's interesting because at once, do you mix a lot of formats? Do you have, is it, you know, you're not just an interview show. You're not just a host co-host show. You're not just a go on location show. I mean, like, you're mixing it all, right? So how does that, is that generally a good thing? Or do people say, hey, we really want you to stick to book reviews? We're not so interested in the interview.
I'm not a total believer in interview shows. We don't do a lot of just interview. We believe in segments. Part of the reason I believe in segments is we can build more sponsors into the show too that way. So we do segments. Our interviews may be 15, 20 minutes. In an hour show, we might have three other segments we do. A horses and history segment might last 10 minutes. A veterinary segment might last 10 minutes. So we'll build those segments in for the people with shorter attention spans. It works out beautifully. And occasionally we'll do a longer interview if we think it's
valuable. Have you always been a segmented show, or did
you? No, we started out doing interviews, and I got bored, and I figured my listeners were too, so that's why we went to segments. And to be honest, I had more sponsors, and I needed more spots to put them, so we created segments that would work for the sponsors, and it just worked. It's good content. It's also sponsored. We make a little money, and it just worked out well for us. And so all the shows we start with segments now. They're all segmented.
Cool. I also learned, don't buy a horse. So expensive. You just said every owner has a veterinarian. That just sounds way too expensive.
The cheapest thing about buying a horse is buying the horse.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I'm going to have you talk to my daughter at some point. She'll probably want a horse, and I'm going to say no to that. But
remember, the cheapest thing is buying it. Everything else is
horses horse. And boats. Just don't do it. Horses
boats are good. It's a good example.
Ray, Dave, sometimes I feel like we're in the wrong industry.
We are.
Well, and you know what? When people start podcasts, I hear another soapbox of mine, sorry. When people start podcasts, I tell them to niche. Dave knows this. I preach this. I tell them niche, 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 because niches is actually, if you want to make any money, if you don't worry about it. But if you actually want to make some income, niches is where the money's at.
Can you back yourself too far into a corner?
I have a show that's about carriage driving. That's my smallest show I have and one of our most profitable shows.
But Amish people don't listen to podcasts, do they?
No, they don't. No, they don't. But we have a show that's about draft horses that I happen to know some Amish people are listening to, because guess what? Ooh. All Amish people now have? Cell phones.
Oh, okay. See, well,
they all have cell phones. And
there's
they
a
all
chance to reach everybody.
There's yeah, a chance to right. reach And they're everybody. Listening. Don't believe they aren't.
No, I know.
Bad no joke. More Amish jokes. All right.
I figured they weren't listening. I figured it's safe. It's a safe joke, people.
We do have to be careful on the Draft Horse show that we don't have any.
So, when you start a show and you're thinking how niche, UK people, how much can I drill down? Is there a danger in going too far, or is it okay and you can work yourself out of it? Rod?
I think we have a lot of people that give you, it's back to the same example, that driving radio show or the draft horse show, which is really niche. We have a lot of people that listen to those shows because they're entertaining. Mm-hmm. They listen because they like the hosts. They don't necessarily have a draft horse. They don't drive a carriage. We've had a lot of people, by the way, start driving their horse because they listen to the driving show because they like the hosts.
You know, one of the first podcasts I started listening to every episode was like this ultra light backpacking podcast. This community, it's all about shaving ounces, right? And they're going up like the Pacific Crest Trail. And I've never done that. I didn't plan to do it. There was people climbing Everest. I'm certainly not going to do that. Yet I listened, right? And I mean, it was extremely niche. So yeah, you don't know who the audience is going to be. You know, another thing about that, let's forget about money, throw out money altogether. Just being found. We're talking about distribution and finding your audience.
It's the same thing though, isn't it?
You can stick out.
It's that's right. Found. And you know, you talk about when you start is probably the perfect time to go to a blog and association. I want to work with you. I'll do the tech side, because remember, they don't have the people. I'll do the tech side. You do your, you know, you help with the content. I'll do the tech side. Let's start this together. That's probably the perfect time to do it.
I think that what we see in the space is, if you don't already have a big following, then a niche is your most powerful place. Now, you can get a big following by being in a niche,
right?
But you have to niche down first. And then at some point, people will follow you to wherever you go. Like, we do have, I wouldn't say that I have a massive following, but we have people who started watching the TV show Once Upon a Time because we do a podcast about it. And they wanted to follow us when we launched the other podcast. So they wanted to watch what we were watching so that they could listen to more content from us.
All right. Why did they do that? What was the reason that they did that? What's it come back to?
Us. Yeah.
Exactly. They like the hosts.
Yeah.
Well, that's the cliche. I always say people come for the content and stay for the host, right? But there is some truth to that. You know? And that is a special intimacy. Man, I feel like I'm throwing out cliche after cliche when a podcast, but there's a special connection to the podcaster that an audience has. And this happens in other media too, but it seems to happen a lot in podcasting, maybe because you're joining them every week. You do that with some TV shows, but it's just something different. And
in the past, it was columnists, wasn't it? The Dave Barrys of the world in the past. Right, you know, right. We're just the new
nothing is new here. Yes.
Yeah. Glenn said my two favorite words.
Dave Barry.
Dave Barry, man. Huge influence on me.
I used to read it every week in the newspaper.
Yeah. There you go. Hey, you don't know Chris Brogan is. I don't know who that is.
Speaking of huge influence, Nick Suberline in the chat said, Glenn is a major inspiration to me. I'm hoping to someday create a daily show/network.
Yes.
Make sure you say that.
Did I say how much work all of this is? Did I make that
Nick does know.
I work 100 hours a week.
Nick definitely knows how much work it is. He built a whole show, scrapped it, and starting over.
By the way, my daily show, 5 days a week, is our most popular show.
I listen on Friday. Most popular. They have a horse.
Most popular. Hold on. Most popular in number of listens or
everything.
Consistent listens?
Most money, most number of listens, most listeners. And
why? I mean, we got to be careful here. Because
Dave, why? Well, Dave, why is it? You don't have a horse, you listen. Why?
I listen on Fridays because you have, like, what is it called? Bad ads?
Really bad ads. Yeah.
Really bad ads. They're hilarious. And so I tune in and they're talking about who knows what, something horse thing, feather, whatever, mane, I don't know, but it's, and I'm like, okay, cool. But they're having fun. They're laughing. And I'm actually getting somewhat educated about horses now. But man, when they get to the bad ads, I'm laughing out loud. It's hilarious. So I tune in because as Glenn says, you know, don't be boring, and it's entertaining and it's funny. And because it's, you don't have to have a horse to like those. So I tune into those, but when he goes deep into the weeds and the horse stuff, I'm like, all right, not for me. But Friday, I'm in all day.
You're coming, actually, in a couple of weeks to see me.
Yeah, I'm coming. I'll be in Tampa, Florida, yeah.
Podcasting, you're going to read bad ads, by the way. He's going to read bad ads. He doesn't know that yet, but that's part of what
he's
doing.
Make him read it in the Binky and the Wiz voice. let's really blow it out here.
Oh, that'd be good, actually. I thank you for that.
Yeah, well, if you want to hire me. Okay. I got ideas. Right. Emily in the chat. Thanks for joining us, Emily. She's awesome. And she says she misses playing the What's Behind Ray game. Yeah, I'm sorry. That's just a wall.
Some boring pictures.
This picture's. Yeah. So, yeah, always changing. This is a new setup, but
you could do the glove and boots thing. And that is, you have one picture frame that every time you're on video, there's something else in that picture. And then it could even be like a hotspot that you can click on YouTube that takes them to something secret.
My wife bought this awesome picture frame where it's like, actually the picture is just a thin, it's magnetic. So it, like, you can literally just change the picture. So, hey, maybe we can get a sponsor. Magnetic picture frames.
Daniel, can you make all those lights twinkle and stuff?
Oh, they go crazy.
But it might make people vomit.
Yeah, it's going to give us... We're going to be a regular Wang Chung video, dating myself, but we are going to have a seizure here.
I knew that was.
Well, we're all old here. Our niche skews pretty old. I just got... hey, by the way, if you have Instagram, you can convert it to a business account. If you have a Facebook page, the insights or the stats you get are really cool. And everyone that's consuming is pretty much my age. So, Daniel, you don't like that?
Well, I've heard Social Media Examiner podcast recently. They talked about that, and they said that the engagement noticeably dropped when they converted to a business account, but you can get access to those same Instagram analytics if you run an ad from Facebook and you have your Instagram and Facebook accounts linked somehow. I forget the actual details, but it was something like that.
Yeah, we'll look into it. I'm having fun. Maybe you can back out of it. I don't know, but something to think about. All right. Well, as we wrap out here, we're going to wrap out. Dave's going to give us a wrap.
Go, go, Dave.
As we wrap up, anything, I mean, we talked about, we know where we need to be. If you're a podcast, we know where you need to live. You got to be on iTunes. You're going to be in all those places. Daniel lists on his website. That's important. You want to be where people are searching for shows. And then, you know, Glenn, great examples of just reaching out to all these different partners, which seems to be the major driver of his shows. I mean, it's just, if not, I mean, you definitely are reaching the people who want to get this content, even if they didn't know they wanted it, right? They didn't discover, hey, there's a podcast about this. What's a podcast? I'll listen. This is amazing, right? So think about those different ways. And if you're a podcaster, think about, you know, with a show, think about all those different ways to sort of cross promote or work with those other partners, bringing on authors or whatever it is. There's like a million things in this round. So rewind, you can do that. Rewind. Press the button. And how painful was rewind, but so great at the same time, technology. Anyways, if you have any more thoughts about distributing your podcast, let us know. But after that, just tell us where we can find your show. And I'll actually I'll say go to podcastersroundtable.com. Definitely go to the YouTube channel, subscribe. That's important. We're trying to build that up. But my recommendation, I'll just give it here. And it's the one podcast, the word of mouth that I always throw out is you have to go listen to Glenn on Dave's show. It's like it's my favorite episode. I don't know. He does Binky and the Wiz. That's pretty funny. But if you want to know about monetization, how Glenn is doing all this and the niche and how powerful that is, go listen to that. Dave, what episode is that?
schoolofpodcasting.com/Glenn. That's two N's because he's just so good. Glenn in the number one.
That was great. Yeah. I bet it's one of your most popular episodes.
Hands down.
Hands down. Okay, so Dave Jackson, thanks for joining us once again. Where can we find your show? Besides the URL I just asked you to give. That was good.
Schoolofpodcasting.com. And the other thing I want to point out, Glenn was talking about asking all these people stuff. If they say no, that doesn't mean your show stinks. And that just means you're that much closer to the next yes. So don't freak out. Don't change your show. Don't quit. You're going to get a no here and there.
They're also not going to punch you in the face, Dave.
It's sales. 1 in 10 nine out of 10 are going to tell you no.
Yeah.
It's sales. It's like anything else. But by the way, some of those people told me no years ago are coming back begging now.
Yeah.
Ha!
Glenn, thanks for joining us on your first 0.5 roundtable, your first half roundtable.
I don't know if seeing me is a good thing, actually, but we'll go with it. HorseRadioNetwork.com.
Perfect. Dan J. Lewis, co-host extraordinaire. Thank you so much.
My one tip, I know we've given a lot of things out here. I would suggest pick one of these things and get really good at it. It's very easy, and I feel this often too, to get overwhelmed with, oh, I need to try this. I need to try this. I need to try this. All of these dozen things, and you end up being really bad at all of them. Pick one that looks like it would be the most effective. Implement it. Work on it. Work hard on it and get really good at it. And then later on, you can work on the others.
Thank you. I've been doing this for 9 years. So, you know, that's a very good advice.
I'm just finding out how hard this stuff is. Man, I wish I would have known that starting.
I'm going to quit now.
That's it. It's over.
And I'm at theaudacitytopodcast.com.
All right, everyone. Podcastroundtable.com. We'll see you on round 84. We're out of here. Wave goodbye.
Bye, everybody.
See ya. See ya.